Those of y'all who are in here, let's go ahead and stand. Let's get started with our time of worship tonight. Please sing along with me. This is one of my favorite hymns to play.
The years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me he died at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin guilty soul and poor in turn to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly serve him as my king. Now my raptured soul can only sing to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Nathan and Christy. We appreciate that. So we continue our Red Words series tonight. Anybody know what the next Red Words are? Have you looked ahead in John to see what the next Red Words are? They'll be familiar ones. Have you looked ahead? Jesus said, I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That's the next Red Words. Probably some of the most popular Red Words in the world. Ones that we know better than any others, when Jesus says you must be born again. I read an illustration about Ben Franklin. He was a great statesman, as we know. He was an inventor, got credit for electricity. I'm not sure he did it all by himself, but he got credit for that. He was also a great writer, a correspondent, and he wrote to and received letters to famous people from all over the world. And one day he received what was probably the most important letter he ever received. It was from George Whitefield, famous British preacher. I did a term paper on George Whitefield in seminary, 15 pages about George Whitefield. I don't remember a lot of it, but I could tell you a lot about George Whitefield. He was quite the guy. He wrote Ben Franklin a letter because they were corresponding back and forth, and here's what he wrote as part of the letter, and I quote, I find that you grow more and more famous in the learned world, Whitefield wrote, as you have made such progress in investigating the mysteries of electricity. I now humbly urge you to give diligent heed to the mystery of the new birth. It is a most important and interesting study, and when mastered, will richly repay you for your pains. And born again is a popular term. I remember when I was barely a voting age, first president I ever voted for was Jimmy Carter. And I don't know if you remember, but Jimmy Carter ran as being born again. And for several presidential cycles there, it was amazing, they were all born again because they saw that that was a popular thing with Christians and around the force of Christians around the United States. Now, you know, I don't remember hearing anybody say they were born again in the last few elections. I kind of doubt if any of them were, but I don't know for sure. But I hadn't heard anybody say that, but it really was made popular by Jimmy Carter, and then many followed that. And born again has become such a popular term in culture that even those outside of Christian cultures have heard what it means, or heard about the phrase at least, born again. I even saw an article recently with protest posters where they were calling us born-again bigots because of our stand on biblical sexuality. Just an amazing thing, but I guess if I've got to be a born-again bigot to believe the Bible, I'll be glad to be one. I don't know about you. The word has been so overused at this point in society as a whole that I wonder if we've lost the wonder and the amazement of what it really means, of what it really is. Being born again is not just a term, it's a miracle. And Jesus explained it to Nicodemus one night. And that's where we're at. So let's read that scripture, John chapter 3, starting with the first verse. John chapter 3, starting with the first verse. There was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to him at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one could perform these signs you do unless God were with him." And Jesus replied, "I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus replied in verse 4, "But how can anyone be born when he is old?" Nicodemus asked him, "Can he enter his mother's womb a second time and be born?" And Jesus answered, more red letter words, "I assure you, unless someone is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Whatever is born of flesh is flesh, and whatever is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed that I have told you, you must be born again." So we're going to break that down tonight and see exactly what Jesus was saying and talk about the mystery of the new birth. I'm assuming Sunday night, church, I'm looking around. I'm assuming probably everybody in here is born again. I hope that you are. If you're not, I hope you'll discover what it means to be born again. But I believe you are. I don't know that. I can't judge that. That's between you and the Lord. Let me paint you a picture of what's going on in this passage of Scripture. Jesus had been out ministering and preaching all day long. At the end of a very long day, he'd gone back to the home of friends. And we know that he didn't have his own home to stay in. He frequently stayed with friends and others. And so we know that he goes back to the home of friends that he's been invited to stay with that night. It's a beautiful evening. There's a gentle, refreshing wind blowing. The air conditioner wasn't working because they didn't have those back then. And so many times they would have rooftop courtyards where they could go and be refreshed by the evening wind when it cooled down. And so that's what Jesus did. He goes to the roof to enjoy the night, time of relaxation. And then an important visitor came to see him, a very, very important visitor. And so verse 1 says, there was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus. Nicodemus was an important man. He was from the Pharisees. Now, we talk about the Pharisees mostly in negative ways, don't we, when we preach and we teach? We talk about them mostly in negative ways, but they were not all bad people. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, which means separated. He was a separated one. He was an elite theologian. He was dedicated to studying the law and living out every jot and tittle of the Old Testament law. He was a teacher of teachers. He was a ruler of the Jews. As a Pharisee, not only was he an important religious person, but evidently as a ruler of the Jews, he would have been, that means he was a member of the Sanhedrin court. You have to understand that the Sanhedrin was the ruler of the land. You know, the Sanhedrin was like the Supreme Court here and the Congress and the president all rolled into one. And they were in charge of the government in Israel. Israel did not have a religious hierarchy and a government hierarchy. It was one and the same. There was no secular and church. It was all together. And the only thing that they didn't have authority over was what the Romans said you don't have authority over, because they were being occupied by the Romans. Just like Russia right now is trying to occupy Ukraine. We don't know what's ahead. That's what happened in the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire came in, they conquered the Jews, they destroyed the temple in 70 AD, and the Jews were under under the Romans at this point too, and so they rebelled later, and the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. But anyway, they were under Roman rule. They were part of the Roman Empire. I kind of look at it like this. In Missouri, we have a governor, and we have a state legislature. And they're in charge of the law in Missouri until they get in the way of the federal government. That's kind of the way it was. They were in charge of the land, the Pharisees were, not all the Pharisees, but the Sanhedrin. They were in charge of the land, and they could do whatever they wanted pretty much until the Roman government said, nope, can't do that. They still had to listen to the Roman government. So they were the ruling authorities. He was a member of the ruling council. He was a member of the council that oversaw all the religious life and all the government life, not only in Jerusalem, but in all of Judea. And he was only subject, this council was only subject to the Romans. Verse 2, this man came to him at night. Now that brings a lot of questions, doesn't it? Why did he come at night? Did he come at night because he didn't want anybody to see him? Did he come at night because he was afraid of what the other Pharisees would say? Probably not. Not all of the Pharisees were hypocrites. Jesus called them vipers and hypocrites and all kinds of wonderful names that were true. They weren't just insults. They were the truth of who they were. But all of them weren't that way. I mean, we know there were those that got Jesus' body and buried him in their own tomb. So we know all of the Pharisees weren't that way. So we don't know exactly where Nicodemus stood, but, you know, he probably didn't come for that reason. He probably came at night because he was a man with a sincere quest for the truth. He wanted to know the truth. He was looking for deep spiritual truth. He was probably waiting for a time when Jesus would be alone and could give him his full attention. Night is a time of darkness, isn't it? Darkness comes in the night. Nicodemus had so much raw knowledge. He understood the Old Testament law in such an amazing way as a Pharisee. He had so much religion. Nobody could have been more religious than a Pharisee in that land. And he even understood that Jesus was a teacher from God. How do we know that? Because in the next part of the verse, he calls him rabbi, which means teacher. He understood that Jesus was a teacher from God. But still, he was living in the darkness. He was in spiritual darkness. He was religious. He understood it all the Old Testament. He was powerful, but he was living in spiritual darkness. He had a deep religious hunger, and yet a profound spiritual blindness. He just was missing it. Many live so close to the truth, but in darkness. I would say to you that in the United States of America, that most people are deeply spiritual, or at least try to be. They're seeking spiritual things. Now, many of them are seeking it in all the wrong places. They're looking for spiritual things in all the wrong places, but most people, I mean, I know we've got our agnostics, which basically means I'm ignorant. We have our atheist, who actually means I'm a fool, according to the Bible. I know we have some of those, but there are a lot of people seeking spiritual guidance in this world. They're seeking it through Eastern mysticism religions. They're seeking it through false religions. They're seeking it through made-up religions. They're seeking spirituality. Unfortunately, they are so close to the truth, and yet so far away, because the only truth that will ever be found will be in Jesus Christ and in who he was in God. So this man, Nicodemus, came to him at night seeking the truth. I really believe he was probably seeking the truth. And he said to him, Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher. Rabbi does not just mean my teacher. Rabbi is a term of great respect. A rabbi would have a group of disciples, sound familiar, like Jesus did, that he would lead and teach and spend time with. And so the disciples that we call the apostles were students of Jesus. He was their rabbi. Nicodemus understood that he was a rabbi with a lot of understanding, and he understood that he came from God. Now, a lot of them didn't get that, but Nicodemus did. And you say, well, how do we know he really believed that? Well, Nicodemus, remember, spirituality, studied the law, tried to live by the law. For him to lie would be breaking the law. So I don't believe Nicodemus was a liar. I believe he really thought that Jesus was a great teacher sent from God. By the way, he's not the first person to be wrong about Jesus. There are a lot of people, Muslims believe that Jesus was a great teacher of God. They just don't believe he's the Savior. There are many others who will tell you that Jesus Christ was a great man, a great teacher. But they'll go short of saying he was the Son of God. And that's where, obviously, Nicodemus is at this point. He didn't understand him to be the Messiah, the Son of God, but he did understand he was a great teacher. And evidently he represented a group from the Sanhedrin who was sincere about knowing who Jesus was and what his purpose was. If you remember, I just envision when we had the passion play and this huge set of steps coming up and, you know, the Lord's Supper table up there. Do you remember that set? And I remember the Pharisees, some of the Pharisees standing on those steps and talking about who Jesus was. And the high priest was saying, we got to kill him, we got to do this, got to do that. And several of them were saying, no. Joseph of Arimathea was saying, no, I think we need to listen to this guy. Nicodemus was, we need to listen to this guy. And I just remember that in the play, but that's, I believe, what was really going on. I believe there was a group of the Sanhedrin who were not happy about how things were being done. Just like there's probably a group, a quiet group, in Washington, D.C., that are not happy about things or the way things are being done right now. Probably of both parties. This group probably wasn't as insincere as the rest of the Sanhedrin. The rest of the Sanhedrin was worried about losing their power to this man, Jesus. They were worried about hanging on to their power at all cost. Pretty political, isn't it? They were worried about hanging on to their power at all costs. They didn't care about their country. They didn't care about the people. They didn't care whether Jesus was really from God or not. They just wanted their power. I'll let you draw the conclusions to that one. But the bottom line is everybody didn't agree with that. And some were really seeking the truth. And he says to Jesus, for no one could perform these signs you do unless God was with him. Nicodemus had been watching from a distance. Nicodemus had seen and heard about some of the things that Jesus Christ had done. And he had been drawn towards Jesus, not just because he was a great teacher, but because he saw these miracles. And these miracles God used as the credentials for Jesus Christ. Nobody else could do those things unless they were from God. Nicodemus says, that proves you're from God. So I got some questions. So Jesus read his mind and his heart. He knew what was coming. Verse 3, we see the red words. Jesus said, I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, it looks like Nicodemus is bragging on Jesus and, you know, trying to get to a question. And Jesus just goes off on a tangent. What's this stuff about being born again? He could have said, Nicodemus, I've seen you. I know you're a good guy. I know you're trying hard. You know, let me explain all this to you. But he didn't do that. He just looked at Nicodemus and said, I assure you that unless someone's born again, he can't see the kingdom of God. Jesus took something that people understood, and he gave it a spiritual meaning. Everybody understood what it meant to be born, probably more then than they do now. They watched animals being born because it was an agricultural type community. They didn't go to the hospital. I know things have changed now, but I don't remember because I was there when my kids were born, but I remember before that, it used to be you go to the hospital, the wife goes in with the doctors, has the baby, the man stands out in the lobby and waits until they come and tell him the baby's been born, and then he passes out cigars. I mean, that's the way it used to be, right? Some of you may be old enough to remember it that way. I don't know. So you didn't see the birth. When I saw my first child born, I was amazed at what being born again meant. It just related in such a way. And their babies weren't born in hospitals for the most part. They had seen birth. They understood birth. The whole world understands what it means to be born. In fact, the whole world celebrates birthdays. Birthdays. Jesus takes this universal physical experience and he uses it to explain a spiritual truth. Nicodemus, if you really want to understand who is of God, and who is of the kingdom of God, because you said, I am from God. Nicodemus, if you really want to understand that, you must be born again. Wow. What does born again mean? It means a new start. What if you could go back and start life over again, knowing everything that you know right now and get it right the second time? Man, I've thought about that a lot. Wouldn't it be awesome to go back to where your kids were first born, knowing what you know now, and raise them different? I don't think there's any of us wouldn't do some things different. You know, That's what being born again means. It means a second chance. It means starting over. It means new life. When a baby is born in this world, there's a new life. When a person is born again, there's another chance, a starting over, a new life. In verse 4, Nicodemus, you know, this flies right over him. He doesn't get it. He's a smart man, obviously. But in verse 4, he says, how can anyone be born when he's old? Nicodemus asked Jesus, can he enter his mother's womb a second time and be born? Man, I'd hate to be that mother. And he knows that's not possible. So Nicodemus completely misses the spiritual meaning of what Jesus has said. He's still thinking about the physical and wondering, what kind of a crazy guy is this I'm on the roof with? And Jesus is talking about the spiritual. But how else could he respond? In spite of all his religious knowledge, all of his legalistic living, he's totally locked in the flesh at this point, and he has missed the spiritual part of a relationship with God. That's not different today. When we talk to people about being born again, they want to talk about what denomination their parents were. When you ask somebody, are you born again? They want to tell you that their parents and their grandparents were members of the church, and they were born again. David Jeremiah said this morning, God has no grandchildren, only children. You don't get to heaven because your daddy or your grandpa or anybody else in the family was a Christian. You ask people if they're born again, so many times they'll say, well, I go to church at so-and-so. No, that's not the question. A lot of people go to church that are not born again. Or they'll tell you what religious ceremonies they've been through to make sure they go to heaven. You know, baptized as a baby, confirmed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Last rites when you die. That's not going to get you to heaven. The question is, are you born again? Are you born again? Nicodemus' answer, it makes sense. How can you wipe out physical growth and go back? But spiritually and morally, are we not the sum of all of our experiences, good and bad? Surely we can't wipe all of our experiences out, good and bad, and start over again, but we can. That's what being born again is. We can. The new birth is not an intensified continuation of the old ways. It's not, Nicodemus, you got it all right, just do it a little better. It's not a continuation of the old ways. The new birth, being born again, is not trying harder to be good. You ever try hard to be good? Man, I just don't do very well at that. You know, I've been trying hard to be good. I got my heart doctor appointment coming up in a month, about a month and a week. And I'm way more than now than the last time I saw him. So I've been trying to do better. In fact, I did pretty good this week until we went out to eat last night. And we split the meal. I ate half of a steak, half an order of onion rings. I ate, you know, half of a blackberry cobbler. No, just a piece of it. Okay, let's get that right. Just a piece of it. And then Cindy and I split a frozen Coke before we came home. So I didn't do so good last night, but I've been doing better. But when I try to do good, I got to have some motivation. And the best motivation in the world for me is I don't want to hear the doctor tell me I'm obese again. Because that's what he told me the very first time I met him. I'd been to another doctor I didn't like very much. He didn't have much bedside manner, so I went to see Dr. Wynn up at St. Francis Hospital. I liked him from the beginning, and the first thing he did was look at me and say, you're obese. If you don't lose some weight, you're going to die young. That's what he said to me, this little bitty thin guy standing there telling me this. But that's what he said, and amazingly, I liked him anyway, and he's been a motivating factor for me. It's hard to be good, isn't it? It's hard to be good, no matter what area of life you're talking about. It's hard to be good. So we can't be good on our own. It's not trying harder to be good. It's not a more urgent desire to be close to the Lord. We have that, I hope. But it's more than that. You can't do that on your own either. It's not a New Year's resolution. Have you ever made a New Year's resolution that lasted past the end of January? It's not a New Year's resolution. It's not a decision to get back into church. Yes, you ought to be in church. But it's not a decision to get back into church. Being born again is not a decision to come back to church. Being born again is not something new added to our old way of thinking. I remember preaching in India, and I remember a lady coming up to me. I'm sure I've told you this before, at the end of one of the services in a courtyard. And it happened to be the night that we had a dust storm, and I preached through a dust storm. And it was in an open courtyard where there were animals, pigs, chickens, all kinds of animals in the courtyard. And the dust was so thick you could barely see through it. My Bible that I took with me on that trip, I can still shake dust out of it. I had dust in my eyes, dust in my hair. Try talking without getting dust in your mouth in the middle of a dust storm. The lights went out, so I couldn't read my Bible and my notes anymore, so I'm preaching just with the presence of the Holy Spirit. And at the end, the dust storm kind of ended. It never did rain. People thought rain was coming, but it was just a dust storm. And at the end, this lady came up, and there was a line of people that wanted me to pray for them. And so this lady came up, and she said, "Will you pray for my legs? My legs hurt all the time. If you see the way they squat and sit instead of sitting on a bench, you'd know why their legs hurt." And she said, and she had the Hindu dot in the middle of her forehead. And I said, "Ma'am, are you a Hindu?" She said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, I will pray for you. But let me be really clear. If you really want Jesus to heal you, you need to receive him. But not as one of your little gods that you put on the shelf, because Hindus have many, many gods that they pray to, and they have little images on their shelves. Not as one of those. If you really want Jesus to touch your life, you have to turn your back on all of that and only worship him." She didn't do that night that I remember. But it's not a decision to add something new to our old way of thinking. Being born again is not just saying the right words. I believe there are a lot of people over the years in many, many churches and many countries who have prayed to, quote, receive Jesus when they just prayed the words and they didn't mean them. It's not just words. It's a total change of heart. It's not just trying to behave right, which is pretty close to what I said about being good. You know, people tell me all the time to behave myself. They usually mean it in a good way, but I know deep down I can't do that. Only God can help me to do that. You see, being born again is not any of those things. Many have become religious. They've covered the old self over with good deeds. They've covered the old self over with religious language. And yet, they are not a new creation. They have not been born again. They have not started over with Jesus. They have not given their heart to Jesus. And they are not what the Bible calls a new creation, reborn. No, being born again is a total new beginning, a starting over again. 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and look, new things have come." When you are born again, everything is new, and the old is gone. It's been forgiven, and it's gone. Just as a human birth is a mystery and a reality, there's an even deeper mystery and a deeper reality about the new birth. The joining of two parents creates a physical birth, doesn't it? Wanted or unwanted. The two parents are the spiritual birth, or what? The Word of God and the Spirit of God. The truth of the Word of God, the Spirit of God, bringing it alive, are what brings the new birth. The newborn person has a new heart, new eyes, and as we talked about this morning, a new family where there's joy in the house of the Lord. Verse 5, Jesus answered, and here's some more red words. Jesus said, "I assure you, unless someone is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Now, that's been taken out of context many times. Some people look at that verse and say, "See, baptism is necessary for salvation." It disagrees with everything else in the chapter. It's totally out of context. When Jesus says water and Spirit, what has he just been talking about? Being born and being born again. He's just continuing the same thought. Being born of water is physical birth. Now, I know this is not why. I know that in order to get rid of the men folk, when a lady would have a baby at home, they'd tell him to go boil the water. I don't know if they ever used it or not, but I don't know what that's for. But I know that when a new baby is born physically, there's water that breaks. Hopefully not while you're standing in a crowd, but there's water that breaks. And the water that breaks is kind of the precursor to the baby coming. You go to the hospital to have the baby when you're in labor. If your water hasn't broken yet, what's the first thing the doctor does? He breaks your water. So there's water. So the water represents physical birth. But it's not the physical birth that counts, it's the heart. When he talks about the Spirit, born of the water and the Spirit is the Holy Spirit that enters your life when you believe. It's the witness of the Spirit from within. It's the Holy Spirit in you that makes you not into a better person, but into a different person. It's not good enough to be a better person. We need to be a different person. And then more red words, verse 6. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh. Again, same thought, okay? Physical birth versus spiritual birth. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh. Whatever is born in the Spirit is spirit. He compares it to the physical birth, but he makes it very clear they're two completely different things. And then in verse 7, he finishes the thought and says, "Do not be amazed that I told you, you must be born again." Now, he didn't say, "Nicodemus, you got it together, you're okay, but some of those heathens out there, they need to be born again." No, he looked at Nicodemus, ruler of the Jews, educated, knew the Old Testament laws as well as anybody else, did his best to live by every jot and tittle of the law as a Pharisee, had a sincere and honest heart, trying to live out the Jewish faith, and looked Nicodemus in the eyes one-on-one and said, "Nicodemus, you must be born again. All the rest of that's not good enough." Man, I wonder how many people, if he was walking on this earth, that are religious, they're in church every time the doors are open, that are trying to be good people, I wonder how many he would look in the eyes and say, "That's all fine, but that's not good enough. You must be born again." It may not be popular in today's world to tell people that their life is not good enough, no matter how good they try to be. They can do all the good stuff they want. They can feed the poor. They can send money to Ukraine. I don't know why I keep saying Romania. I hope they don't get involved. A lot of people over there I know and love. Bottom line is, that's not going to do it. To get to heaven, you must be born again. Nick was born a Jew, part of God's covenant people. Certainly his birth was better than that of a Samaritan, or his birth was that better than that of a non-Jew, a Gentile. His life was pretty close to perfect, probably way more perfect than mine is. He was a faithful Pharisee, a Jew of Jews. Nicodemus could have looked at him and thought, "Well, surely somebody else, but not a practicing Jew like me." What did Jesus say? "Nicodemus, you must be born again." And think about what we hear today. "Well, my parents were Baptist. I've been in church all my life. I'm a moral person. I still cling to the wife of my youth. I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't fool around, and I don't carouse. Do I need to be born again?" Now, maybe that drug addict, that alcoholic, he needs to be born again. That person that's, you know, attacking the Bible and attacking Christians, he needs to be born again. But what about me? I mean, I'm a good person. Do I need to be born again? And the answer is, you must be born again. None of us are good enough. In fact, there's none good. No, not one, the Bible says. The only perfect person that ever lived is Jesus. Every one of us has sinned, and every one of us needs to be born again. Hope tonight you got a little better understanding of what it means to be born again. We have 12 minutes left. Would anybody like to stand and tell us about when you were born again? Any testimonies tonight? Well, y'all are really shy on the testimonies. Anybody here born again? You want to tell us about it? Okay. Thank you, Opal. Amen. Thank you, Opal. Thanks for opening the door. Somebody else?
Yeah.
Okay. The sad thing when a church dies. The church I was saved in, Red Star Baptist Church, is no longer in that building anymore either. When you talk about a woman like that, that dressed in the gloves, and I think of Miss Minnie Boone in her hats. Y'all that knew Miss Minnie Boone, she was a very proper lady, and she wore a hat every Sunday morning. So you didn't want to sit behind her because you wouldn't be able to see. Somebody else, that was good. Anybody else want to share? All right, let's stand and we'll be dismissed in prayer then. Appreciate you being here tonight. Appreciate what God's doing in our church. I don't know about you, but I was excited this morning. And I've heard a lot of excitement. People are excited about this series. Pray for me that I know I can't bring the joy, but pray for me that I'll do my part and that God will use his words to touch lives. I just think we might be on the verge of something. I'm pretty excited about it. Earl, would you lead us in our closing prayer?